Hi, this is a minute of Overpass. My name is Eric and I make apps. Now this week I want to talk about source code control. Okay, so this week I want to talk a little bit about source code control, which admittedly is kind of a boring topic, right? It's something that if you're a software developer, if you're like a professional software developer and you've been doing it for a long time, you've most likely used source code control in the past. I've been using it for years, and by source code control I mean Git, Subversion, SourceSafe, Team Foundation Server. I've used all of these in the past and lots of other different variations, but they all pretty much work the same. They give you the same benefits, and it's something that's so important to do when you're developing an app or any kind of software, but it's very easy not to do is to have a good plan of source code control. So what I want to do now is show you kind of what we do and how we do it with our projects, right? And the reason I'm bringing this up is I've been hearing from a lot of people lately who have hired other developers, and you know, either individuals or companies, and when it comes to source code control, they don't have access to the code, or they're sending files back and forth to each other and things like that. And it really is that there's software has been around for so long that there's ways of working in a team environment that are much easier. And if you're hiring developers, you really should have something where you could check on progress on a regular basis rather than waiting till the end of the project and then doing like a front-end check. So even if you're not a developer, this is also something that's very important. Now source code control is we've been using for Overpass, we've been using Subversion for many years. So everything that we've been doing has been in Subversion up until about a year ago when we finally took and moved everything over to Git. And Git is sort of the current the popular one at the moment. Now I know there's lots of discussions out there. Like I said, I'm not going to go into the details of what's different between all of them, but I will go through how we use Git and just how easy it is. Now the reason, again, I was talking to a client and he didn't quite understand what I was talking about. So once I demonstrated it to him, he said, "Oh, okay, I get what you mean." So what source code control does is that every time you make a change or a series of changes, or maybe once every few days, you could just check in your code into the source code repository, and then other developers could get access to it. Or even if they don't, you would be able to have like a pin in your code. So if I'm going to do something dangerous in the code, and not even dangerous, I'm just going to make a small change. What I'll do is I'll check in my code saying, this is where the code is at version 1.1. And then I'll make some changes, and that way, if the changes are successful, I may check them again as version 1.2, or you know, if I release it, I'll say the current release version, or I may say testing this version, and then that way, if I completely mess it up, because you might be changing code all over the place, if I completely mess it up, I could roll back to the previous version, or if I release a new version and there's like a bug, and we're sure that it was working in the last version, we could still go through and pull down the code from that previous version, compile it, and compile the new one, and find out if there is a discrepancy between the two, and why was it working before and not working now, and what has changed, and everything like that. So, what we were using before, we used so many different source code control hosts. We used to do it ourselves. So I did have my own Subversion server. However, it's so cheap you could do it for free with other companies, privately hosted source code control. Or the last one we were using was CloudForge, and they were pretty good, but it was like $10 or $20 a month. And we recently moved everything over to Bitbucket, and Bitbucket is really good with like the free program. So you can set up lots of different projects, and I think up to 5 developers, it's still free. So let me give you let me just show you my screen here so you can see what I mean by Bitbucket. So here's some of our recent projects from my Bitbucket dashboard. So you can see, I'm going to gray out some of this because it's client projects. However, you can see here some of the code here. There's the SPI framework. The last time it was updated, some other things. Most of it's client projects, so I'm just going to gray out most of it here. So let me go into the SPI framework in here. Right. So here's one that our developer is working on. So I was not working on this project, but somebody that was working for me was. So what he was doing is every few days he would check in a new version of the code. So he would work for a few days and he would make a commit. So if I go into the dashboard here, I can see that Joey last committed the build for the spy framework, which is Chinese spy, on the 22nd of December. You just put a little comment there. I can see if I go into this, I can see what's actually changed in that build. So I can see the files that he's actually updated. If I go into that file, I can see what's changed from the previous version to this version. So it gives you a lot of control. But also I could go into the source here and just look at all the source code control. And more importantly, as I could just go through and download all the code using the git commands and run it locally. So and I can make a change and I can push those changes. So let me go through the whole process here so you see what I mean. And again, if you're an experienced software developer, you've done all this before. I'm not going to go into anything that's too specific because a lot of this stuff is made overly complicated. I think just by using what I'm going to show you now, you are so much better off than if you don't use anything at all, right? So we get, you can go into branching and merging and all that kind of stuff, which is more advanced. But even if you were just to commit and push changes, you'd be better off. So let me go into the code over here. Here's the code for the spy framework. So this is the Joey's last version here. Let's say I go through and I make a change. So this is just I'm going to put a comment in here. So comment made by Eric. This is Lua using Corona SDK, actually, if you're wondering. So comment made by Eric. So I could go through here and I could say print comment. So this won't actually change the code. And I go through and I save it. So it's made a change. Now, this is fine. If I was to just go through and changing all the code, everything would be fine. You know, I'm backing it up with Time Machine anyway, so I would have a local copy. However, if my hard drive crashed and my Time Machine crashed or my house burnt down, all of that code would be lost. However, so what I do is every so often I'll go through and go into the command line here, which is under that folder. And you initialize a Git repository. And Git stands for, I don't know what it stands for, you can look it up or put it in the comments. But you can just go through here and say Git add, so add anything that's been missing from here. So that's the first command I use on a regular basis. Then I go Git commit dash M, and don't let the command line put you off. It's like I said, four commands is all you really need. Git commit M, and I'll put Eric's changes for 11 Jan or whatever. If you have people working for you, like I said, I like to have commits frequently. I don't want to go too long without it. We've had so many hard drive crashes, here and there, or things being lost, or things being messed up that, you want to check in as often as you can. So then I go commit and it basically goes through and it checks in all the code there that's new. So anything that's been changed recently gets put in there. Now with Git, it's different than other source code controls because this just did it checked it in locally. So if my hard drive crashes, I still lose this. So what I need to do is push it to the server, which is Bitbucket. So the next command I do, the third command, I just do Git push. And sometimes you can put the origin, or the origin or where it goes. And it says Git push, and basically what that does is take the code and push it to the server. So if I go back to Bitbucket and I refresh this, or actually if I go into the dashboard here, you can see here that Eric pushed a change for the 11th of January, 16 seconds ago. If I went into that, I could see that what's actually changed and everything's been checked in there. And you can see here, it's been added my comment. So, and what this means is that if Joey's working on the code or another developer's working on the code, rather than me sending them the change saying, hey, I made this change and we have to try to keep things in sync, all he would have to do is go into Git under his code and just say Git pull. So, and that basically what that will do is take the latest version of the code and update his version. So we can both work on the code at the same time. However, like as you saw, he was doing most of the code, but I, as a project owner, was able to just check to make sure things were being done all everything well, okay. And like I said, Bitbucket's the one we're using at the moment, but there's lots of other ones. So those four commands, git add, git commit to check it in locally, git push pushes it to the server, and if my hard drive crashes, if the building burns down, it doesn't matter. You know, it's I could still get a new laptop and pull down that code, and everything's done. And then the other developers could go through and say git pull. The other things I could do is go through into Bitbucket and add and remove permissions based on that code. So rather than send the code off and everything's all over the place, then dependent on someone else's machine, I have access to the code at all times. Now, doing this with code is very easy. You could also do it with other things like documentation. You could set up a folder for your key stores. If you're doing an Android app, you definitely want to put your key stores someplace safe. You could say Dropbox or one, you know, on an external hard drive. But if you put it into a source code repository, then it's very safe. And it's like I said, and you saw how quick that was. It's not a long process. It's like every few days they can, ooh, I better check this in. You know, git add, git commit, git push. I don't have to worry about it anymore. And the good thing about this is if I go through and I make loads of changes locally and nothing works again, and I just wish I had never touched it in the first place. It was some stupid idea to begin with to make a change to the code, and I completely mess everything up. I could just revert. I could do git, I think it's git revert, and just roll back the changes. Or I could just go look and see what's actually been changed, and I could go through the git Bitbucket front end. I could do git diff, and there's loads of other commands to roll back to the changes the way you had. So what you should be doing, if you don't already, is every time you release an app to the App Store, is at least have it pinned so that you could see if you had to go back and look at what was in that version versus what's the current changes you can do. Like I said, you should also be checking in things like the PSD files for Photoshop, any other information you need. If you're using a database, the database schema, in case, like say, your server goes down and you need to rebuild it, yeah, everything's done. And what this is what professional developers do. You must have some sort of source code repository. But it's so easy not to do. It's so easy to ignore it. And you know, as boring as it is, I wanted to go through it this week and just you know, say, if you're not using source code control, you really should. So that's it for this week. I hope you enjoyed it. I'll talk to you next week. Goodbye. Hey, I really hope you liked that video. Now I do these once a week, so if you want to hear more, or you want to hear more about our experiences with the App Store, either Google Play or iTunes, please go ahead and subscribe to the channel, and please like this video and leave a comment. I love reading the comments. I love hearing what you have to say, even if it's just hello or whatever. And like I say before, if you're not sure what to say in a comment, like I never know what to say in a comment, I'll make it easier for you. Like if you liked it, just go ahead and say gnarly, which is an 80s term. Or if you didn't like it, just say bogus. And if you didn't think any of it, just say eh, right? So that would be a big help. And another thing you could do, which I'd really appreciate it, if you're on the App Store and you want to try one of our apps, look up some of the Overpass apps, applications either on iTunes or Google Play, and leave a review and let us know what you think about it, either good or bad. But it's we're all trying to build up in the market, so that would be a big help. So that's it. I'll talk to you next week.